Welcome to our new episode of Conversation Across Borders, a collaboration between GlobalNet 21 and Tracy's Dreams. Today we are going to speak about intercultural communication and storytelling. This means a topic really related to our core interests when we want, and we are really happy to welcome Joanna Sell with us. And I say first, good morning to Francis. Everything fine with you, Francis?
It is, yeah.
And Joanna, thank you so much for being with us. We are really happy to have you. You have a lot of experience in this field, and I would first ask you, could you please tell us about yourself or what you do, who you are, and more?
Thank you, Nerina and Francis, for the cordial invitation. I'm really glad to be here. As you have said, I am intercultural coach, trainer, facilitator. Nevertheless, at one point, I started to work more and more with stories. So I got really curious what it is all about when I had an internship at the TV channel in France, in Strasbourg. I'm pretty sure most of the people are familiar with this channel. It's Arte. And back then, they had German and French program. Afterwards, they expanded also lingually and multiculturally to really offer the program for all the people in Europe. So right now, they are broadcasting in English, Polish and Spanish, additionally to German and French. However, back then when I was over there, there were really fantastic discussions what it actually means European, what it actually means multicultural or bicultural, who are they preparing the program for? And what I realized was that even though most of the people were bilingual and they were really fluent in both languages, French and German, they use completely different cultural codes. So there was this communication gap somehow. And it triggered me a lot. And it was the moment when I decided to add one more qualification to my studies. And I studied intercultural trainer and coach at the university in Jena in Germany. Yes, this is how the adventure started.
Okay, and you know, you talked about, I mean, we live in a complex world and you talked about these cultural codes. And I know you've written a bit about saying that the question we should ask each other is, who are you? Now, I would find that a terrible, difficult question and I don't think I could answer it. Why do you think it's important?
I'm really sure that it's important, especially right now, when our world, so to say, is upside down. For many, many people, it's a very challenging year, us included. This is also the year when many people rethink what is important to them, what is their purpose, what passion they want to have more of, and also how they want to live up to their fullest potential. Because this is also something that many, many people neglected because, you know, they were caught in the routines. And when I say they, I always emphasize people who are mostly in the corporate world, that there is really not so much time to think of what is my passion, what is, you know, my biggest dream, what are my skills I would like to invent more of. And then I realized that when I talk to many leaders within this last month, that they said, oh, I had to regenerate quite a lot. I had to change quite a lot. So this question, who are you? It's actually this question, which is really our basic human question, you know? So what is important to us? How can we actually contribute to build better futures?
And Johanna, You told us a little bit how you came up with the idea to become an intercultural trainer, but what is this? What do you do actually, and what, why?
My why is really that people not only understand one another better way across cultures, but really that they can enjoy this cross-cultural collaboration, really enjoy. So that it's not something that I pretty often encountered in the corporate context when I was offering, or I still am, trainings and coachings, especially for virtual leaders, when I ask them, so why do you do that? Why have you decided to go for this career, to be a virtual global leader? And pretty often I heard, because I had to, you know? So right now I'm struggling with working with people from different cultures, but this is also this career path. And I really am sure that when we work on a mindset and invest some time and energy also in changing of our heart set, then we can enjoy this collaboration much, much more. Yeah, just to give you a very, very important example, many people I train or coach say that they struggle with authenticity in the global context. And this is exactly the question, who are you? Yeah, and this authenticity struggle is really very important because they realize that in the global context, they need to adapt their behavior to new cultural norms, cultural values. Sometimes they are contradictory to their own values, to their own set of, you know, ideas, how their world of obviousness works. And the authenticity issue is really, really tricky. This is something what Andy Molinsky is actually talking about when he talks about cultural dexterity, that on one hand side, we are aware of it, that we need to adapt this behavior. On the other hand side, it raises the stress level because in many situations, we are not prepared for it. So actually what is really important with this authenticity for leader is that as soon as they get courage to share stories and also to listen to stories so that people are really, you know, ready to say what is important to them, then they can really address this challenge with authenticity. They can simply say, okay, in my corner of the world, we would do this that way, so to say. This is what is obvious to me. Nevertheless, I'm really happy to hear what is best working in this context, how I could adapt, and really to show this authenticity that nobody can be prepared for all the possibilities in the intercultural world, so that everybody is really also vulnerable, you know.
But how do you jump from your corner of the world to having a global sense of authenticity? I mean, for example, you were brought up in Poland, and in a couple of weeks' time, I'm doing a webinar interview with someone who's written a book on Poland, a novel. And it goes through the 70s, the 80s, solidarity, the student movement, fall of the Berlin Wall, and the concept as well of what Polishness is. So, I mean, doesn't that, you know, sort of influence you quite heavily, even though you've moved to Germany, and in a way you're sort of mixed up in terms of your corner of the world? And how do you sort of get out from that, what authenticity is?
I guess it's accepting transformation. I think this is really what helps us being authentic, so that we don't stick to just one big narration, just like you have said, something that really shaped me as a young person living in Poland, that it's just part of it, you know, because when we talk about cultural influences, obviously we don't only talk about upbringing and the influences of the country, of the region, and so on and so forth, but also the social background, age, plays a very important role. Gender plays a very important role. So just to give you a very funny example, the biggest issue I had with moving to Germany wasn't really, you know, being from Poland, moving to Germany, but being a woman, first of all, in Poland and then in Germany. And in Poland, everybody expected a woman, really, you know, a powerful woman who is taking care of everything, having makeup, wearing a dress, high heels, and everything that people associate with being a woman. And when I moved here, I realized that many, many times those women who really are successful in the corporate world, they have very strongly adapted to the male world, so to say, in the German context. So most of them having short haircut, no high heels, you know, just suits and stuff like that. So, you know, when we are talking about intercultural differences, they can take place at different levels. And when I wrote my book about the Polish business culture for the German audience, I had this self-reflection, okay, what it actually means for German, Austrian, or, you know, German-speaking Swiss partners to dive into this world of obviousness in Poland. And this perspective changed, helped me also a lot to have a little bit of, let's say, this practice of expanding my own comfort zone, you know, so that I had the understanding for both perspectives. And whenever I realize that me, myself, I bring them as well, that I could switch them dependingly on the context. So this is something we can train, we can really practice, and this is what helps.
And Joanna, and this, so we define very often culture as a set of stories that we enter. And you wrote that, for example, intercultural communication is a balancing act between searching for similarities and realizing differences. And storytelling is a powerful, I wouldn't say instrument, but storytelling is a way to work with intercultural communication, in work, cultural communication. Can you tell us more about this?
Definitely, definitely. Oh, thank you, Marina. Thank you, Marina, because this is really fantastic how we can actually work with stories. What you have just said, it was the quote by Jerome Bronner, the US psychologist, cultural psychologist, who actually was born to Polish immigrants. And he said that culture is a set of stories that we enter. And, you know, I was so much like, oh, wow, great. We've got this definition that involves also narratives. And then when I thought of it, I said, it's just part of the truth. Because on one hand side, obviously, we enter a certain set of stories. However, what especially COVID shows us all the time is that at the same time, we co-create it. So culture is a set of stories that we enter and that we co-create. So, you know, when we think of future, that it's a space, it's not a space that we enter. It's a space we really co-create on purpose. And this is exactly the same with culture. So right now we are negotiating ways how we want to greet each other. Yeah, we don't shake hands any longer. In February, it was still part of the game, or at the beginning of March. So we need to negotiate lots of things that used to be our world of obviousness and are not longer valid. And I think this co-creation process is really what makes us also human, you know, that whenever we see that we've got the same vision and really good intentions to reach the goal, then this co-creation is really not such a struggle, because we realize that we can profit from these cultural differences and not to see them as a burden. So whenever I've got intercultural training, coaching in the corporate world, the best feedback is actually when people say, oh, you know what? I'm taking from this program that I can really smile much more. I can be, you know, more relaxed. And whenever I don't understand something, I can simply address it because I don't have to know everything. Yeah.
Yeah. But, you know, you say that, but that sort of raises the question, what is a story that is effective? I mean, for example, take climate change. Lots of people, according to opinion polls, are getting really, really worried about climate change, but they won't move from concern to action. And people are saying storytelling is the way to do it. But you have to find a way of getting beyond those statistics, don't you, that cognitive stuff, and relate to people emotionally, and even beyond that in a way. Now, how do you do that?
Yeah. So if there is no struggle, there is no story. Every story has got the beginning, a struggle, so a challenge, and the end. And you just addressed the example with the climate change. And again, it depends on the group who is telling the story. Yeah. Who is communicating and with what means this very powerful, sometimes dominant narrative. And I would say that, you know, the story, the magic of sharing stories is exactly this, Francis, what you have just emphasized, that we are definitely addressing not only facts, not only data and facts, but we are talking, so to say, from person to person, from heart to heart. So we also address the emotional level. And whenever we use these emotions, people would simply feel it. They wouldn't hear it maybe so much, they would feel it. And what actually happens in the brain? There is a huge idea of, you know, why storytelling works so well. Whenever we hear facts, these facts are landing in our brain in the cortex. So they are really, you know, just put in certain drawers. They remained over there. And if they are not embedded in the story that makes sense to us, they won't mean so much. However, when we have the same facts embedded in the story, what actually happens is that our hippocampus is activated, and hippocampus is responsible for memory. So we automatically relate to this story through our experiences, through our former knowledge, through our wisdom. Amygdala gets triggered. And amygdala is also responsible for dealing with emotions. Yeah. So immediately we relate to this human factor of exchange. And this is the beauty of stories, so that we can have better understanding why the other person, especially in the global context, acts the way he, she does. And the understanding is the first step to really build more awareness and more acceptance for this what's going on. And you know, the point is that when we think of for example the climate change, yes, Theory U and Dr. Sharmer, and you know, the whole context of what's going on right now, what we've witnessed is that there is a huge regeneration movement. So people are getting rid of this worn off stories, the stories that don't serve us any longer, and they switch to stories that are much more powerful for this reality.
And
yeah, so maybe one more example, not from the climate change, but from the corporate context. Very, very often we heard the term the VUCA world. Yeah, volatile, uncertain, complex, ambiguous. all these words, when people hear them, they are already, you know, tense. Yeah, the tension rises. And when we re-narrate such a term, when we say, okay, this is just part of the reality that everything is so uncertain, what about addressing the other part, especially for people who are leading in the global context? What about saying that the storytelling so is so important because the leader is not only active in this volatile world, but also with his approach when he also shares, especially right now, that something is bothering him in the COVID time, that he shows this human side and not only, you know, this operational one, that he shows vulnerability, then we've got completely different story.
You wrote just an article about this topic,
yeah,
and you try to redefine this VUCA with, let's say, definition related to storytelling.
Yeah.
Could you tell us more about this and explain what are the parts that are relevant here?
Yeah, so, you know, the first step for every leader is really this vulnerability. So really to think who I am in this whole context. Yeah. And then when it's clear for this person how he or she can lead the people and can really take the responsibility, then it's the switch from volatility to vulnerability. The second step is from uncertainty towards understanding. So people need to understand one, why this person wants to lead them. Yeah, what is the intention behind? What is the purpose of all these changes that this person is introducing? So people really need clarity. Yeah, the times are really uncertain, no question. However, those people who are able to bring more clarity, to bring also more hope, yeah, that things are going to work, these are the true leaders. And then when we think of complexity, definitely the world is extremely complex. And still what such a leader can actually enhance is connectivity, especially the social connectivity, so that really people have spaces where they can meet even in the informal context. Yeah, so we are currently witnessing this shift from social distancing to distance socializing. So distance socializing, when we really are, you know, you are in Great Britain, you are in Rome right now, I'm based in Germany, and still we have got the space where we can chat, when we can laugh, when we can have a virtual cup of tea or coffee, where we can really, you know, talk about things related to our passion, to our jobs, but not only, because this informal context in COVID has disappeared. People don't meet anymore.
So does that mean, from what you're saying, that in a way, because we are distancing socially, we can redefine what home is? So you've written something, I think, called Driving Home for Christmas. I know in Poland, for example, many people say that because Poland has in its history been dominated by other countries, they just walked across it, that the idea of Poland is in their mind, it's not territorial. To take it with you. So is home something that's complex and combines a lot of experiences, and it's comparing those experiences that creates the authenticity that you want to do in terms of creating a global culture?
It's not about creating a global culture, because I think it shouldn't be our aim. I think our aim should be that people from different backgrounds have the sense of belonging, even in settings where they notice that they are pretty different from the rest. And we are able to create such a sense of belonging and such a level of trust. We are. And I think, you know, you have just address something very, very important regarding my culture of origin, that there are still so many migrants worldwide. So the biggest, second biggest Polish city after Warsaw is actually Chicago. Yeah. Also with the community of, I don't know, even more than 1 million Polish people. And that people really have this home, so to say, in their heart, and it's part of the DNA. I guess it's not only about Polish people, you know, it's in general about people who are moving, and it doesn't really matter whether these are expats, whether these are migrants, or whether these are refugees. As you see, we are talking all the time about people who don't live in their place of birth and upbringing anymore. We just use different labels to label the situation. And
yes,
yeah, this is the point that we don't have to decide, all right, now I'm French, I'm German, I'm whoever. We can leave this multicultural influences. So you have just addressed it with Christmas. This year we are staying here, and this year actually we are not eating fish and potatoes. This year we are having fondue for Christmas Eve, you know. So it's also about embracing different traditions and enjoying it so that it feels natural, so that we don't miss something. Yeah. And still for the Christmas Eve, there is one more tradition. And this tradition is originally from Poland, that we are sharing the so-called opłatek. It's a piece of, let's say, dough that you give to one another, you break it, and you wish all the best the other person and say what you are grateful for. So this is a beautiful tradition, you know, and this merge of rituals, of habits, everybody can have. It's just the question of attitude.
Yeah, so it's, Joanna, there are so many, many questions that I would love to ask you, because there are so many aspects. So I am Italian, you know, I used to live in Germany, in Sweden. Now I came back to Italy. And this is really the big question. Who am I? And this embracing of different aspects of me being a woman, an elderly woman, perhaps. The question is really, in your experience, if we concentrate on one aspect, we live really in intercultural setting. We work with intercultural teams, and you wrote also that somehow we struggle about being in this situation. What do we need, or what can we do to overcome this, to make it as positive? In your opinion, what do the people miss who are struggling the most in this situation?
The positive attitude. The positive attitude is really, it's better to be present than to be perfect. Yeah. So if we want to do everything well, we put ourselves under pressure a lot. And when we have got also courage to admit that something is not clear, that we don't know what's going on around, that we don't understand someone's behavior, when we have got courage also to ask this person what is behind and how we can, you know, have this co-creation process of how can we negotiate what happens next, and then it feels much, much better. So a part of this optimism and the positive attitude, definitely patience and kind of lightness, you know. So this is, of course, sometimes pretty tricky, because when we are triggered to say something, to react immediately, then our brain is constructed this way that we really either fight or fly. Yeah. And we don't need to fight, really. It's just sometimes enough to breathe deeply and to say, okay, I don't get it. I don't know what's going on here. Yeah.
And Joanna, are we different person or different people in different cultures or in different languages?
Yes, the language has got a huge impact on our thinking patterns. Definitely, yes. And I still remember I talked to a colleague of mine who is a psychologist. She comes originally from Russia and she has lived in the United States for many, many years right now, I guess even longer than in Russia before. And she said that she failed the same test in English and in Russian. And in US English, American English, she came across as much more proactive and much more assertive, the same person. When she failed the same test in Russian, she thought about herself. She perceived herself in Russian with all these thinking patterns she brought from her home country. And then she automatically was less assertive and really, you know, let's say more humble. I don't really want to create black and white scenarios right now, but this is exactly what happened. So this is something that we definitely know that it exists. There is also research regarding this dynamics. I guess what is really funny in our field is, you know, that people really start the conversation with negotiating, okay, so what language are we talking right now? Yeah, because some people are really multilingual. So, okay, right now, is there any option? Do we lose someone if we switch to another language, or we include everyone? So it's also about, you know, being attentive to really inclusion all the time. And the other thing is that it's not so much about searching for differences, you know. I guess it's more that we should think consciously how we can really create from this cultural diversity more inclusion. And these differences are just seen as enrichment, as additional perspectives, how we can solve problems. Because right now, in our times, we need this, you know, collective intelligence to solve complex problems. So it doesn't bring us any forward to quarrel who is right and who is wrong, but really to listen to each other for best ideas, what might work. And this story listening is definitely the key word.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we've sort of come to the end of our half hour. We've gone over it. We've got a lot of questions we could have asked as well. So, you know, it's been a sort of really full interview, you know, with a lot of useful information to people, but a lot of questions that still could be asked, which, you know, would help to enrich the idea of storytelling, because, you know, I, like Marina, think storytelling is really an important form of communication. And it can find the sort of commonality that exists between all of us. And that's really, really important. So, you know, Joanna, thank you for doing it. And Marina, as always, for taking part in it and for finding Joanna and bringing her to the screen for us, which is great. So thank you for doing it and, you know, for joining us today. And we'll finish this interview now.